I am not a paranormal investigator. I am an author. While looking for inspiration for a book, I came across a series of stories surrounding a home in the American Pacific Northwest. It is an extremely ordinary-looking house in an extremely ordinary-looking residential neighborhood. But the stories that have emanated from its former residents and the people who lived in the town that it's located in are quite extraordinary. Through my research of the house on Wendell Lane, I have come across accounts that range from the supernatural to just plain bizarre. In order to protect the privacy of the people in the town, as well as the current inhabitants of the house on Wendell Lane, I have not only changed the name of everyone in these stories, but the name of the street as well. Wendell Lane is just an alias for the true location of these accounts. I visited the town that the house is located in during the summer of this year. I thought that meeting people face to face would be a good opportunity to learn more about the house on Wendell Lane, but I noticed quickly that my inquiries were met with a strange resistance from most of the town folks I questioned. Many were not interested in speaking to me. Others were standoffish when I brought up the house. I did get a few people to agree to sit down with me, but my interviews with them yielded little to nothing in regards to the information I was hoping to hear. I was all but ready to give up when I received a voicemail on my phone.
You have one new message. Main menu. To listen to your messages, press 1. Sorry. First, new message.
You're the writer that's been asking around about the house on Wendell Lane, right? Your number's been floating around town. Not a lot of people like to talk about the place, and well, some of us are discouraged too. Speaking of that, I don't think you really should be hanging around much longer. All your interviews are starting to piss the wrong people off. Now, me personally, I ain't got a dog in the race. Sure, I've heard about the house, but there ain't much I can really tell you about it you probably don't already know. There's a guy who might be able to help you, though. His name's Bill Huckley. We got to talking when we heard you were in town, and he told me he wanted to meet with you. You can find him at AJ's tonight. It's a bar just off exit 31. He comes in every Friday and gets hammered. I'll be there tonight, too. You won't know it. We ain't gonna meet in person. Some of the people who don't like you might also stop through, so be careful. One more thing. I suggest you don't hang around too much longer. They won't be able to cause trouble for you outside of town.
The message I received also informed me to ask Bill about Jim Baker, one of the more recent residents of the house on Wendell Lane. I assumed that there was some kind of a connection between the two of them. I arrived at AJ's that night around 10 p.m. The bar was a total dive, but I was surprised by how crowded it was. Part of me couldn't help but wonder if the mysterious caller was watching me as I scanned the room. I also wondered if anyone the caller had warned me about was there as well. I asked the bartender if she knew whether or not Bill Huckley was in the establishment that evening, and she pointed me towards a middle-aged man with salt-and-pepper hair and a 5 o'clock shadow shooting pool in the back of the bar. It was Bill. I made my way over and introduced myself to him. To my surprise, he was willing to talk to me about the house, and Jim Baker as well. We sat down, I turned my tape recorder on, and that's when his story began.
Yeah, I knew Jim Baker. Jimbo is what I called him. Played my fantasy football league last year, good guy. But the dude was a total fish. Drafted a kicker in the third round, easy money. Hadn't been doing too well this season, but I just picked up Buffalo's second string running back, and now I'm one blown ACL away from riding that horse to the playoffs, baby. You see, the key is to snag the guys who back up the guys with brittle bones and tendons that'll snap like Kit Kat bars. Then it's really just about playing the waiting game. What we were talking about again? Oh yeah, Jimbo. He's a real mousy-looking cat, short and skinny. He had a beard, but he kept the thing so neatly trimmed that it looked like he painted it on his face before he left the house every morning. Wore thick glasses. One of the smartest guys you'll ever meet unless he was talking football. I think he was one of those, not hippie, but what do they call him now? Hipsters? Yeah, that's it. Anyway, I ain't saying he was a fairy, but Jimbo came in this bar every weekend, and not once did I ever see him with a woman. You'd think he'd be cleaning up, too, because he was pretty well off for a guy in his early 30s, drove a Benz, made a bunch of money in tech, then he decided to take a break from the fast life. Apparently he had a public freakout a while back, said the stress had been building in him for years. Suppose that's why he moved out here and bought the house. Speaking of the house, I guess you've heard the stories, huh? Must have taken pretty seriously if you came all the way from California just to follow up on Jimbo. As for me, I never believed the rumors. Every town's got a stupid urban legend, and ours was no different. Still, every time something happened in that house, this community would work themselves into a frenzy, which meant I'd have to hear people ramble about the place for weeks. All the while, I'm the guy going, maybe the only reason old Lady McNeely suddenly dropped dead in her living room was because old Lady McNeely was 102 years old. Seriously. That old bag was so ancient, when she farted, sawdust came out her ass and people wanted to call in an exorcist when she finally croaked. Now, have no fear, buddy. You ain't leaving here empty-handed. I knew you flew up here for a story, and trust me when I tell you this, have I got a story for you. But before I tell it, I'm going to need a drink. I'll grab this round, you get the next. Hey, bartender, 4 shots of Jack, and, what'll you be having? All started around 6 months back. I was here at the bar when Jimbo walked in. He sat down right here at the table, and Trashy Tammy took his order. Guy looked like hell. Sweating bullets, and his face was whiter than a Klan meeting at the North Pole. At this point, we had grown to be pretty good acquaintances, you know, drinking buddies. So I could tell something was really bugging him when he didn't come up and say hi. He was just sitting there, staring off into space, not even touching his cheese fries. So I decided to mosey on over and see how he was doing. Sit down at the table, and before I even get to ask him what the deal is, it all comes pouring out of him. Tells me he saw a cockroach in his kitchen earlier that night. Says he can't stand the thought of being under the same roof with the thing. I ask him, why didn't he just kill it? And get this, he tells me he tried and just about burned his house down in the process. Yeah, good old Jimbo. Tried to roast the roach with one of those fancy blowtorches people use to brown the tops of creme brulee, but the sucker moved and his wallpaper caught instead. Now, I'm laughing so hard at the guy that I nearly fall out of my chair. Can you imagine almost setting your kitchen on fire because you're too chicken to mush a bug? It was even funnier to me because I run a pest control company. Second biggest privately owned in the region, thank you very much, so killing bugs comes naturally to me. Once I catch my breath, I tell him I'd send one of my guys over to his place in the morning if he needed somebody to take care of it. That cheers him up right away. He hires me on the spot. I buy him a beer. He doesn't mention the cockroach again for the rest of the night. Next morning, I tell Miguel, my most trusted soldier, to spray Jimbo's house down. Once he finishes, Miguel shoots me a text to let me know that everything was copacetic. But that afternoon, I get a call from Jimbo. His voice is trembling on the phone. He says the cockroach isn't dead. I can hear the anxiousness in his voice, and he's asking me how long it takes before the poison starts working. Now, I'm not sure how much you understand about the delicate science of pest control, but my guys aren't messing around with the wimpy junk you get over the counter. We only use the very finest insecticides on the market, and any roach exposed to that stuff should belly up within a matter of minutes. So the fact that Jimbo was telling me we didn't get the job done left me more than a little perturbed. I asked him if he's sure the cockroach is still alive, and he tells me that he's looking at it on the wall in his bathroom, and that it's even bigger than before. At least 4 inches long, not including the antennas. That's a big effing roach. As a matter of fact, the only cockroach that's even known to grow that large is the Blabberus giganteus, otherwise known to a layman like yourself as the giant burrowing cockroach of Australia. And those are only native to, well, Australia. So I tell Jimbo that I'm coming down myself to scope the situation out. When I get there, the guy opens the door and he's shaking like a meth head coming down from a 3-day bender. On top of that, he's nursing a pretty nasty lump on the back of his head. He tells me that after he got off the phone, he swatted at the thing with a rolled-up magazine. Nailed it dead on. Didn't even budge an inch. Then he reared back to whack it again. The cockroach went on the offensive. It fluttered its wings and launched itself at him and buzzed around in his face. When he tried to scream, the nasty thing forced its way into his mouth, and Jimbo tells me it was so long its back end was sticking out of his lips like a cigar. He said it tasted like he was licking a dumpster. So, in all the excitement, Jimbo stumbled backwards, tripping over the bathtub, and damn near knocked himself out when he banged his melon against the wall. Then the cockroach casually crawls out of his mouth and buzzes away. Now, Blabberous Gigantus can't fly, so Jimbo's story ruled out that possibility. But I've never heard of any other type of roach growing even half that size, so I figured he must have been exaggerating. While I'm there, I check his pantry for droppings and egg cases, anything I can use to identify as unwelcome guest, but I can't find a thing. Most people would be relieved to hear that because it would mean that they most likely weren't dealing with an infestation, but most people aren't as high-strung as Jimbo was. He asked if we could tent the place. Normally, I'd strongly advise against fumigating a house for one solitary roach. Why pay thousands of dollars to accomplish the same job I can do with the sole of my boot? Kind of like dropping a live hand grenade down your pants to scratch your ass. But as I look into his eyes, I can see just how hot and bothered that bug has him. So I reluctantly agree and schedule him my next earliest appointment. 2 days later, tent goes up over the house. Hey, don't look at me like that. It's not like he couldn't afford it. I was just helping out a pal. So, what if I made a little money on the side? I'm a good guy, okay? I even let him sleep on my couch while we gassed his house. Once the tent goes up, he shows up at my place with a duffel bag full of clothes and a smile on his face so big you would have thought he just hit the Super Lotto jackpot. My wife made meatloaf that night. Tasted like dog chow, but Jimbo gobbled it up like he hadn't eaten in days. After dinner, me and Jimbo go down to the den to have a beer. I ask him if he's seen the roach again since his run-in with it in the bathroom. He tells me things had been quiet as of late, but he caught a glimpse of it that morning before my guys showed up to fumigate his house. He was walking to the front door when it scuttled past him in the foyer. He said he almost jumped out of his skin when he saw it. According to Jimbo, the roach was about a foot long now and maybe 6 inches tall. Have you ever heard of a cockroach that big? Well, me neither, buddy, and I've pretty much seen it all in my line of work. In fact, I hadn't found any signs of a roach at his place at all, and neither had Miguel. So, I get to thinking about how anxious Jimbo is all the time, and I remember he told me about the nervous breakdown he had that prompted him to retire early and move away from the city. So I start to wonder if the whole cockroach thing is just a figment of his imagination. The roach is all the guy can talk about while he's staying with me. He's obsessed. The next 2 days, it's cockroach this, cockroach that. My wife has the patience of a saint. She better if she's going to stay married to me. But even she was starting to get annoyed with his blabbering. I could tell she was relieved a couple days later when we took the tent down and told Jimbo it was safe to move back in. You know, I really hoped that would be the end of it. But that evening after dinner, I get a knock on my door. And when I open it, it's Jimbo. He's an absolute wreck. He's standing in my doorstep in his PJs with one house slipper on. And I can tell that he's been crying. I ask him what happened. He tells me that he was reading a book in bed when he heard a hissing sound. The noise was coming from directly over his head, so he looked up, and there on the ceiling was the roach, as big as a dog, he tells me. Said it was staring at him and fluttering its wings like it was about to strike again. Well, he rolled out of the bed, hit the ground so hard that he almost separated his shoulder, but he somehow managed to get up and sprint out of the bedroom unscathed. Apparently, he had even phoned the cops, but they reprimanded him for calling 911 just to complain about a cockroach, so that's why he had come to me. Now, at this point, I'm positive Jimbo's lost it, and I know my wife's going to kill me if I let him spend another night on the couch. So this is what I do. I invite him in, give him a beer, tell him to relax while I take care of it. Sometimes when a person is so caught up in their fantasy that they can't tell the difference between what's real and what isn't, the only thing you can do is indulge them. I ask him for his spare key. Then I head out to his place. When I get there, I let myself in the front door. I look around Jimbo's house, and just as I expected, the place is empty. Even the bedroom. So, this is what I do. I send a text to Jimbo, and it reads something like this. Whoa, you were right. That's the biggest sucker I've ever seen. Got it, though. Nailed it point blank in its nasty face with enough insecticide to kill a horse. Euthanized the disgusting thing just in time because it looks like it was ready to lay eggs. Going to dispose of the body properly before the larva hatches. Be back in 15 minutes. Then I leave my hat on his kitchen counter just so he can be sure that I was there. Now, I thought I was pretty crafty, but Jimbo didn't buy my ruse. No matter what I said, he would not go back inside the house. Couldn't help but feel guilty when I told him he couldn't spend the night at my place, but he seemed to understand. I heard he crashed at Richie Hooper's for about a week before Richie's wife kicked him out. Then he spent a couple days at Pete Dunn's. After he had exhausted all his friends, he started shacking up at the budget motel just off the interstate. Didn't see him around after that. Stopped coming into the bar, then all of a sudden cops show up and start asking questions. Turns out he went missing. Melanie Swan was the last to see him. She lived across the street. Said she watched him head inside his house with a brand new hunting rifle. Walked in, Never walked out. Weird, huh? Well, it gets weirder. Remember how I left my hat over at his place? Well, I'd forgotten all about it, and when I finally remembered where it was, Jimbo was already long gone. But I still have the spare key he gave me, so I drive over there after work one day and let myself in the front door. Now, the house is a mess. Chairs are knocked over, the glass coffee table in his living room is broken, the place stinks to hell and back, and I'm thinking it's pretty obvious that Jimbo must have gone off the deep end. I'm feeling really, really sorry for the guy, but then I start to hear a noise coming from the kitchen. Sounds like someone, but there's a shuffling sound. I'm thinking maybe Jimbo came back. I call out his name, but all I hear is more shuffling. Then some kind of crunching sound like someone's biting into an apple. I wonder if there's a burglar in there. I'm against the wall right next to the kitchen door now, and I can hear that there's definitely someone in there. So as quietly as I can, I peer around the corner, and that's when I see it. Jimbo's cockroach, just as real as you and I. It's enormous. If I had to guess, I'd say close to 7 feet long. Standing next to you, it would come up to about your hip. Its antennas are as long as my legs. Thing's eyes are like two black softballs, and its mandibles look like industrial-sized pruning shears. Right away, I recognize the stench in the house is coming from it. It doesn't smell like an ordinary roach infestation. I would have been able to pick that up immediately. No, this was way more pungent. There's really no describing it. Took 2 days to get the stink out of my nostrils, and it still comes back to me from time to time like an acid flashback. The thing is eating something. For a second, I think it's a loaf of bread from Jimbo's pantry, but as it spins in its mouth, I see a face. Jimbo's face. I hear another sickening crunch and realize that noise is the sound of my old pal's skull cracking inside the giant cockroach's maw. I try to back away slowly, but the thing spots me and flutters its wings. The sound is horrific, like 1,000 angry bees getting ready to swarm me. Each beat of its wing hits me with a wave after wave of the noxious stink it produces. I'm pretty sure it wants to attack, but lucky for me, it's too big to take off in Jimbo's tiny kitchen, so it settles down and goes back to chewing on the poor guy's head. I take that as my cue to hightail it out of there. I book it out the door, hop in my car, then put the pedal to the metal. When I get far enough away, I make an anonymous call to the cops and tell them I saw armed gunmen break into Jimbo's house. What was I supposed to say? That there was a giant cockroach eating my missing friend's head? By the time the police arrived, the roach was gone. Never did find Jimbo's body, but I don't think anybody ever will. I believe the stories about that house now, all of them. I keep wondering if I'm going to get a call one day from the next people who buy that place. If I do, I'll tell them to give Orkin a ring because I'll never set foot in there again. There's something wicked in that house. It's your turn to buy the round and don't be cheap. Make mine a double this time.
Son of a bitch. Not again.
Oh, shit!
We're gonna go to Elk Grove, Michigan. That's my hometown. Then put an end to this horse pucky once and for all.
Whatever happened in this town seems to really haunt him.
Ash, I had to summon you. Help me retrieve the book and send them back to hell.
Oh, you need my help. Here's what I need. I need to be back in Jacksonville on my second keg of beer, putting my spicy man meat into a mother-daughter sandwich.
Part of me is already regretting calling you here.
Get used to that feeling. We gave peace a chance. Now it's time for war.
Oh!
like all the others.
Ladies first.
That is horrible and also awesome.
Which is everything that I do.